Sir Oswald Mosley, welcome to a special Today programme. When I say welcome, you know and I know that throughout London, a great many Jewish viewers will not welcome your presence on this programme. Why should any Jewish person now watch you and listen to you?
Well, if they were, some of them have abused me so much, they might be interested to see why. But in fact, there are many great misunderstandings in politics. Now, let us be absolutely clear about this question. I was never anti-Semitic, and I'll define anti-Semitic. By that, I mean someone who attacks Jews on account of race or on account of religion. I had a quarrel, not with all Jews, but with some Jews about one subject, whether there should be a Second World War or not. Now, coming back from the First World War, after that time, in the air and in the trenches and in the loss of all my friends, I was very strongly against another war. And it seemed to me, rightly or wrongly, that's a question we could debate, that certain Jews were trying to provoke a Second World War because their compatriots or co-religionists were admittedly having a very bad time in Germany. Now, I do not think that a minority in this country should pursue a policy contrary to the national interest, which can, and in fact which did, result in the loss of 50 million lives. That gave rise to a very bitter quarrel of the period, in which harsh things were said and harsh things done, because they attacked our meetings. But I was not before that, and I have not been since, or even at the time, was not anti-Semitic, because not all Jews were involved, but only some.
Sir Oswald, your answer, as you well know, begs so many questions that I have to put to
you. Which question?
I'll come to those in a moment, but let me stay with not anti-Semitic, to refer to hecklers as the sweepings of the ghetto?
Well, the people who had just come in, they're very rough, these meetings, then shouting every insult, every abuse at the speaker, and he sees that they have just come in from Central Europe, from totally different conditions, to break up another meeting, gives them a rough answer. I might have said that to any foreigners who came in to try and break up an English meeting. Of course it was rough. People don't understand now in those great mass meetings, which some people were trying to break up, and the speaker had to hold his own, and if you saw that they'd come from another country to break up an English meeting, you gave them a rough answer.
You say that your argument with them was that you wished to prevent a Second World War.
Certainly.
Would not your arguments have been better addressed to Hitler?
The argument was not a Second World War.
Yes, to prevent a Second World War. If you wanted to have an argument with someone, would not the argument have been better addressed to Hitler rather than the Jews?
No, well, Hitler was driving east. My policy and my party was a totally different thing. Fascism in every country was a strongly national movement, therefore was totally different in its form, policy and method. I had wanted to conduct further and better a great commonwealth of nations, had to have a multiracial policy. He wanted to unite the Germans in Eastern Europe, and I did not want to intervene in a world war to stop him doing it. I thought a war between Germany and Russia was better than a war between Germany and Britain. That gave rise to the quarrel.
Sir Oswald, do you now, looking back with the hindsight and knowledge of history, blame the Jews or Hitler for the Second World War?
I blame both. I blame both in that Hitler was impatient. He wanted to drive east, unite his own people. And when we signed the guarantee with
it's
Poland...
It's rather like blaming the victim of a rapist for the rape, isn't it?
Well, no, wait a minute. Let us look at it clearly. Well, Hitler was driving east to unite his own people. We gave a guarantee to Poland, which we could only implement by a world war. In fact, we couldn't save Poland, we didn't. It's like signing a bouncing check. Well, now, the agitation to make us do those ridiculous things like guaranteeing Poland and the other side of Europe was largely due to the influence of some Jews. Therefore, I say that both were responsible. Hitler for driving east before he had got a diplomatic arrangement with us, Jews for gradually persuading us, or the British people or government, to do absurd things which were bound to result in war, all those people made tremendous mistakes. I was against both mistakes. I'm against the persecution of Jews or any other minority. I am also against giving guarantees which you cannot honor. That's what caused the World War.
When did your conversion to being against the persecution of Jews begin?
Well, because I never wanted to persecute Jews myself. I simply defended my meetings from Jewish attacks. Take the Olympia meeting. They marched 2 miles from East London. Afterwards, East London swung over to me, but at that time it was against.
What was it like?
I can tell you exactly what it was like. I went along to make a speech to an enormous audience, a record audience, filling the great Olympia Hall. People who'd marched from East London entered the hall in order to break it up. I had 1,500 stewards in the black shirt, because so they could recognize each other, that's why, in order to stop them doing it. The fighting was then very protracted inside my meeting. I wasn't going to break up my own meeting. They were doing that. Then the cinema lights, which were there in great force, were swung off the platform onto the audience where the fights were occurring. And some people very foolishly said that I wanted that to happen. Well, I've never yet known a speaker who wanted the searchlight turned off himself and onto other people. And that was done by the cinema lights, naturally. If I then had intervened by force, asked my people to swivel the lights back onto me, what an outrage it would be, supposing that your lights were turned off me now onto something else, and I had people around me went and turned them back onto me, you'd rightly think it an outrage. And that was done by the cinema companies who wanted a story.
Sorry, it's
it
not
wasn't
quite
done by me.
You've described what was happening in there. What I'm actually asking you is how you felt addressing what was, by any standards, a huge rally. Did you then feel that the millennium had come and that power was yours for the taking?
Oh, good heavens, no. It took me. I'd spoken all over the country. For 7 years, I spoke at enormous meetings, far the greatest ever held in this country. And 3 years later after that, I addressed an audience twice as big, no, 4 or 5 years later, in 1939, twice as big in the exhibition hall at Earl's Court, never been filled for a meeting on any other occasion. And that meeting was absolutely orderly and immensely enthusiastic, because the attempt to break up our meetings had been defeated. Force was used against us, and we used force in return. I hate force. I had more than enough of force for fighting in air and trench in the First War. But when my meetings were attacked, I either had to close down or defend them, and I organized their defense, and we won. We had orderly meetings, and that was our whole offense.
Do you really hate force, Sir Oswald, or do you not, in fact, have a hankering as a man of action for the quick result that force can achieve?
Oh, no, no. All that nonsense was knocked out of my generation in the First World War. I was flying against the Germans in 1914 to 1915, when the average life was 3 months. All my friends were killed. I was later in the trenches with my own regiment. My whole generation, my whole generation was wiped out. And a man who's been through the First War had a real hatred of war and of violence. But then, if you found a political movement and come out of politics with a certain praise of what you've thought about and what you've done, and you try to go on talking to the same audiences you have before, and people with armed force come to break it up, what do? Blow them a kiss and say, good night, I'm retiring from politics, or say, I'm not going to do this, I'm going to defend my meetings. But I stood firm and defended them.
But does violence, in fact, attract violence?
Precisely. They used violence against us, and we had to use violence in return.
No, but
I don't like it. I hate it.
But what do you have in you, however, Sir Oswald, a concept of the hero?
Of the hero?
Yes.
Well, I think that an element of the heroic is necessary to all great nations. Britain was founded, the British Empire and everything else that we have, was founded by heroism, men who went out to the far corners of the world and did heroic things. But it should be constructive heroism in the service of a great people, in the service of humanity. People who've done marvels in medicine and in science and that sort of thing are equally heroic. It's not simply a military virtue. But I think an element of heroism is what is perhaps lacking today, but I'm convinced the British people are still capable of it, and in a great crisis can show heroic qualities, which should be evoked.
Who are your heroes?
In history? In our history, the great Chatham. They kept him out of politics, out of power, all his life. They gave him 4 years towards the end of it, and he gave them in return everything they've got. Immediately he'd performed that service, they got rid of him again. And any man of action who does anything for our people, or any people for that matter, is well advised when he's done his stuff, he's performed his great service, to go into retirement when he's done it. Chatham was one example. There are many others. In British history, I also give a great part to Marlborough, the original Churchill, who was the two great men, Marlborough and his descendant Winston, extreme opposite of character in every respect. And Marlborough and Chatham, I would put with the two great Latins, Julius Caesar and Napoleon, and with the two great Teutons, the Hohenstaufen and the Hohenzollern Fredericks. I should give those six men as the examples of supreme men of action in history. And when sometimes I'm accused of having modeled myself on this man or that and all that sort of stuff, my simple reply is, well, now, if you're going in for action, study the great models. If you're going to play tennis, go and study the champions at Wimbledon. Study their strokes. See how they do it. And I did study all that kind of person. And it's very essential to do it. That doesn't mean you identify yourself with them. It merely means that you learn from great performers how to do certain things.
Now, it is interesting, of course, that you could choose Chatham, who, as you say, was kept out of political life nearly all his life, and then drawn back. In a shorter interview which we did recently, you gave me the impression that you still believe the call might come for you. Do you really
believe
that?
I'm much better now than I've ever been in my life. I've still
better
got
at what, sir?
Better at politics. That is, I've got health and vigour, every capacity I ever had, and added to it a vast experience, and I hope more wisdom than I had when I was young. At least that seems to be the impression of a good many people. Therefore, while you have health and strength, you go on improving. Experience and wisdom which comes with age is a splendid thing. Of course, when you get past it all, and are physically feeble and the rest of it, then it is over, and any man of any sense recognizes it. That happily history abounds in cases of men who went on to 10 or 15 years older than I am now and did extraordinary things. Therefore, I feel that my whole life has been a training for what can now come. And if I was wanted to perform any part, I don't care what, I would gladly do anything I could for this country.
But who on earth would ask you?
Well, they only ask people when it's necessary. When that man alone has the experience and the proved capacity and willpower to meet a difficult and desperate situation. Anyhow, my life has proved a certain willpower and certain capacity to endure and come through supreme difficulties, which are exactly what this nation will be faced with very shortly.
The poet Yeats said, "Why should not old men be mad? Isn't it a form of madness to believe at 78 that the country will call you?"
No, because countries have called back men much older than me, with great advantage, and things have been done in other spheres of literature, of art, of philosophy as well, by very old men. The only one or two questions are, does the situation require such a man? Is he still capable of doing something effective? Those are the two questions which our audience and the British people as a whole are perfectly capable of judging for themselves. That I have not yet seen anybody else in the present situation who can meet the crisis which is coming.
What would your nation be like then? What would your Britain be like?
I'll tell you exactly what I should propose. I think in a crisis you should have a government drawn from the whole country. I don't mean just a coalition of parties which have failed. That will probably happen like it did with Baldwin MacDonald before.
Would it include Jews?
What?
Would it include Jews?
If they're any good, yes. I know there are certainly one or two of them who are absolutely first rate, particularly in science and so on. Now, what I propose, a government drawn from the whole country at a certain point, from politics the best, certainly, from business, from some of the younger trade unionists who certainly would be available, I think, from the universities, from the fighting services, I should certainly include as well. Because in a very dangerous situation, you want a few members of my original profession, the professional army. Because men who are trained to danger in that situation are very valuable. And such a government, elected by the people at a general election, entirely democratic in form, subject to dismissal any day by the consequent parliament if they abused power, but given the power to act while they are there, just as the board of directors is given power to act by the shareholders and sacked if they don't do the job properly, I think that is the modern form of government, entirely democratic, combining the two essential things, the power to act with individual liberty, which must be scrupulously preserved. No suspending of habeas corpus act, and all those outrages from which I've suffered myself. Habeas corpus act, personal liberty, always there in this country till it's needed. The moment's of the crisis, they scrap it and put people in jail without trial. Absolutely wrong. Give a government power to act, certainly. Dismiss it if it doesn't do the job. And preserve with cast iron
rules. How do we dismiss it,
though?
There would still be elections. There would still be elections.
Oh, certainly. Exactly as today. That any party might enter the election and that the people should choose. But if they give a party or a newly constituted government or proposed government, if they give it power, that is a parliamentary majority, that majority should give it the power to act and should sack them if they don't act properly. Unless and until the people vote for them, the question doesn't arise.
We have a substantial black and brown and coloured population in this country now. Would they be represented in your government
they'd
of all talents?
They'd have a vote in every constituency.
Would they be in your government?
If any of them was a first-rate man, he certainly would be, yes.
What's a first-rate man, Sir Oswald?
First-rate man of proved capacity in any sphere. Scientists and people like that who had nothing whatever to do with politics would certainly be included in the kind of government I suggest. The politicians would be in a minority. And if some black or some Asian had proved himself in some sphere as an outstanding man, he'd obviously be a most welcome member of any government that was formed.
If he hadn't been sent home under your repatriation schemes.
Well, repatriation, that is, I was against, of course, and that was quite often discussed at the time, against them ever coming here. That is, I took a stand way back in 55. I fought an election on the subject in 59, the very strange and dubious election, and I stood for that policy, I think several years before Mr. Powell ever thought of such a thing while he was Minister of Health and introducing coloured nurses into the hospital service. And I was strongly against the thing from the start, when it was perfectly easy to stop it. But now that we've got the figures are very much disputed, but anyhow, a very large number here, it's a much bigger operation to secure any repatriation. And it can only be done in a humane and a decent way. And I think that means the whole of Europe facing the problem together and enabling conditions in their homelands to which they will wish to return. I think it's possible to solve that problem in a decent and humane way, but immeasurably more difficult than it was in 1955 when I first stated publicly that immigration of that kind should be stopped.
This seems to me the thing that has bedeviled you all your life, Sir
yes.
Oswald, that you put forward and advance ideas, obviously in the 30 major economic ideas that might have and should probably should have been taken up. But always you're bedeviled by this desire to find a scapegoat which will rally people around you. In the 30s, the Jews. In the 50s and the 60s and the 70s, the blacks. Who next?
No, well, the answer is, I think, very plain and simple. I was against certain Jews, not all Jews, because they were agitating for war. I was against the import of a completely different alien population which would bedevil our whole civilization and has done it. But that is the only form of prejudice of that kind which can ever be charged against me. For instance, as the Times reported recently in a long article, a study of that period, I stood against the persecution of the Irish, having had to fight them as a professional soldier at the end of the First War. I strongly opposed the treatment of them by the black and tans, and was praised in my early life for my humane treatment of such people. I stand against atrocity and bullying, and I still feel the same today. I am passionately against any ill treatment of prisoners or the underdog. But in those two cases, it was necessary to take action against a minority who were agitating for war, or against the import of another population in an overcrowded island, which has done us immeasurable harm. But we cannot deal with it brutally and inhumanely. We've got to deal with it if we deal on a great scale with the whole of Europe, making arrangements for a fair return of people to their native lands, and that means an enormous enterprise, because there's got to be conditions to which they wish to return.
When you say, and when you think about this call that will come, why should the call come? What is wrong with the political leaders now?
Well, I'll tell you exactly what is wrong. They're running into a supreme crisis because they've failed to solve all the main problems. Now, what is the main problem? The main problem is the failure to adjust consumption to production. That is, in plain language, to give the mass of the people the power to consume the goods the mass of the people produce. Not an insoluble problem, it's a matter of creating conditions in which it can be done. Now, before the war, in my early days in politics, we had deflation, which was a disaster. And some people are proposing it again. They're dressing it up in a lot of new jargon. It's exactly the same policy we saw applied before. All this Keith Joseph Powell stuff of deflating and the rest of it means doing what we did in the 40s, the creation of enormous unemployment. Now, in an effort to escape from that, they've had the contrary, inflation. What you want is a perfectly stable price level with production matched by consumption, and that means two things, a viable area, and within that area, a government given the power to act. Now, in old days, in my youth in politics, we had the British Commonwealth. That was a viable area. And if government had the will, really, to act, we could have solved the problem there. That was thrown away in the Second War. I'm greatly denounced for opposing the Second War, but it lost us everything. And after the war, I said, we must go right into Europe. There's another viable area. And if you have the whole of Europe and a government capable of running the whole of Europe, central government for the main subjects, national governments at the next level exactly like we got today, and regional governments, Scotland, Wales, possibly even Yorkshire and Lancashire, a great devolution, you can solve the problem. If you are insulated from the chaos of world markets and of world finance, a viable area and the power to act, those are the two things which are necessary. Endless detail could be added, but in broad outline, that is what has to be done, and you need a government with the will to act within an area where action is possible.
Don't you understand, Sir Oswald, that what is tied to this will to act is people can see and accept the will to act, but what they are also afraid of are the consequences of the man of action.
Yes, indeed.
And they look at Europe, and they look at other countries which have chosen men of action, some of the left, some of the right, and they see where that ends. Mm. And maybe they say, our nice little muddle is rather better than what men of action give us.
You're absolutely right. You put your finger on the whole complex. And a number of intellectuals say, making these points very fairly the other day, I said, well, what you are saying, that any man who's any damn good is always dangerous, you see. Well, now that is the question. Is it possible to have men who are capable of great action, who are not madmen, who are sane and who are constructive? That is, you have a load of manure which has to be shifted, and you have a strong elephant capable of doing the job for you. Can you be assured that instead of doing the job, he doesn't run amok and run berserk? Now, that the people have got to make up their mind about sooner or later. In ordinary times, and I quite see why, they say no, strong people and strong action is not necessary and it is dangerous. But when things go wrong, it's a bigger risk to let the muddle go to a disaster than to have a man of action. And in those days, I think they will turn to action. I never blame the people, as some of my friends do, for not being ready to take action when the crisis is becoming perfectly obvious, when everybody in the known is aware there's a crisis, and the people are still perfectly content. Now, I say in answer to that, if I read journals and newspapers in four languages, try to read books in four languages as well, if I travel continuously over Europe, America, and everywhere else, seeing every sort of person, far more than any other English politician has ever seen or done of that sort, I can just, working the whole time, keep abreast of events. How on earth can a chap coming out of a factory or coming out of an office, having a drink at the local on the way home, keep abreast with events? And when they say never had it so good, and when wages are going up faster than prices, how can they know what is happening? The question is, when things go wrong, when they wake up, when we see England awake instead of asleep, will they or will they not then want men of action? Well, if they do want men of action, I'd have certain proposals to make to them.
Who would you have around you now if you had to, if you walked into power and you were asked to form this government of men of action and men of talent, who would you have around you?
I deliberately now have no one around me at all. In that, to be precise, in 1966, I finally severed myself from all parties, from all connections, so that I could speak in this country.
Who would be your cabinet? I mean, who would
you... The first step is to see why I separated myself, which was that I wanted to avoid the charge of wanting through an organized party to impose myself, or through clique, or through intrigue, or anything else. What I do is to...
Another reason might be that only 2,000-odd people voted for you, and not in Hillgate, of course.
Well, the 8% of the electorate voted for me, which is more than the difference between the parties. It was a very curious election. A long story could be told about
it. It was hardly a famous victory. What I'm suggesting to you is that you have been rejected by the people when it came to polls. What you are now saying is that you would form this government all talents. What I'm trying to find out is who would you actually have in that government among our contemporary politicians and contemporary talents?
Let's deal with the 2 points. Low votes I've had, not more than 8% since the war. Perfectly true, but I could give you many examples from recent history of people polling far, far less than that, who were in power a very few years later. Because great countries, quite rightly, it's sensible, don't want drastic things to be done before it's necessary. Now, coming to your second point, which is a very sound, who would you put into a government of that sort? Well, now, you would look around you, if you were anyone who was charged with the task, for the men who have most succeeded in their particular line of business, particularly men like scientists of all kinds, particularly men who've succeeded in business, and reasonable trade union leaders, particularly among the younger men. And in fact, in every sphere, there are outstanding people who've never been in politics who would be useful.
Sorry, can you think of a reasonable trade union leader who we might include?
Well, I can think of, I expect they'd promptly be turned out of the trade union if I mention their name. I know among the younger men quite a lot who I would call highly reasonable and are ready for action. And in fact, I've seen trade union leaders on television with you whom I don't think would be unreasonable in a situation of great crisis. They know when everything's easy and going relatively smoothly, they want, and it's their job, to get as much as they can for their members. But the moment things go wrong, those men will be looking for some way out. If the house is on fire, as a trade unionist, a young man said to me...
Sir Oswald, we're in the last 2 minutes, believe it or not. Oh. Isn't it, in fact, a reflection on a political figure, on a man who is devoted to politics, that the only way he can conceive of coming to power or achieving his aims and ends is through a crisis, is through a breakdown in the system as it stands?
No, not if he's always foreseen that a crisis was inevitable. After all, it has been admitted very generously by opponents that I could have been Prime Minister in either of the two main parties. But I could not do what the country wanted done with their policies and with their personnel. Therefore, it was inevitable to act in view of the approaching crisis in a different way, which I have done. And my whole life has been a training for that crisis, which I am certain will arrive, but other people think will not.
Has your whole life not also been a failure?
Yeah, well, my life has been a failure. If the premise on which I based it, a crisis, does not occur, even then I have had some thoughts to offer to my country and the world, which some of which have been accepted. But I agree with you that I'm never given a great part in action, then being a man of action, my life would have been a failure.
So you don't get it, you failed.
If I don't get that, in my terms, as a man of action, I should have failed.
Sir Oswald Mosley, thank you very much indeed.